I know it's fake. It's a bell. It's a bell. We are working on that, and maybe one of the first things that we're able to do. But until then, we'll just do the fake bell. Amen. A couple announcements I do need to make very quickly. For those that don't know, I just want to remind everyone the confirmation class is down the road at the New Tabor Hall, and we meet at 9 down there. Also, I found these in the ashes. I actually went into the fire yesterday, well, the ash heap, and I found something. I found a couple of hymnals that I put over there, the original Czech hymnals. I don't know if we got any of those before, but there's some that were untouched and they're not wet, and I got them over there. I also found, I'm going to move around, guys. I also found this. This trophy goes with this picture. This was back in, I think, 2008. This is what's left of our first place volleyball trophy right here. And I dug it out, took pictures of it, sent it to the boys, because I got three Johnsons that were on that team. And Evan today, Evan Hildebrand, told me today, he said, do we still play volleyball? Can we enter the tournament? I said, yes, we can. And so young people, Evan needs help. Yes? Evan needs some help, and if you'd like to play volleyball, do what?
Five more
about his age. That's right. We need some young people to enter that. You know what we're capable of, so, you know, no pressure. You can do it. You can do it. But anyway, I wanted to point that out to you. But these two little plates here, this one here, we found this after the fire. These have been buried with all the other trophies that most of them are gone. It says, third annual New Tabor Chili Stew Cook-Off, 1996. I say we do that again. And you got one of these from this? Okay. Was it ours? It was a church. So I think this would be fun to do. That these were the trophies that they gave or whatever. But from what I understood is they went in the parking lot. Everybody brought their crock pots of chili or stew. They made it out there.
One crock pot.
See, I'm down with that. That'd be fun. So we put it in the parking lot, and we everybody does their best. And from what I understand, the voting was done by spoons. That you would go, you would. No, you wouldn't want to put that same spoon that you ate out.
I don't remember all that.
Yeah. No, yeah. So, but I think they put the spoons in the chili that they wanted, right? So this looks like a winner. But I think this would be fun. So let's be thinking about that. I think that'd be a great thing for us to do. And something we can do outside that would be wonderful. Do you have any other announcements? We do have a meeting after church. If you're not a member and you don't want to be a part of that, you're welcome to go home. If you sort of want to hear what's going on, I don't mind that. But we do have a meeting immediately after service.
And then immediately after that meeting, the Christian Sisters have a very important meeting. We have to finalize some stuff for the spring, and we have election of officers.
Okay.
While that's going on, the men are going to go to Burleson Heights Apartments and deliver food.
So, guys, what we used to do when the ladies met like that, we'd go sit in the fellowship room. We can't do that anymore. And the ladies are in here, so we're going to go and get our hands to work. So we're going to go and deliver food to the folks out at Burleson Heights Apartment. This is a ministry that we have, Sustaining Life, and it's just a kiss on the cheek to those folks to help them get through the end of the month. So we'll be doing that after service, so let's get together. We have some meat here that we need to get together and go with the bags.
Mm-hmm. If you want to volunteer to help with the food ministry, I'm going to look for it in all this mess I have, and I'll set it out, and you can sign up to go for February, March, April, for the rest of the
okay.
year. I have a sign-up sheet.
Okay. Good, good, good. And I'm going to go ahead and say something that probably everybody knows, and if you don't, sorry to be Debbie Downer here, but Joseph is going to have to leave us, and that's a big deal to me because I've leaned on his technology and everything that he has done, and he's leaving sooner than later, and I believe that the second Sunday in February,
to be determined.
Oh, good. So maybe we're looking at 2025 then. Yeah.
Six.
Yeah. So he has an opportunity to be the head engineer down in Hawaii. Is it ABC? It's a CBS. You're CBS here. Okay, another CBS affiliate in Hawaii. He'll be the head engineer down there. Great opportunity. Really a cool place to go and say you've lived there. And I think that, you know, after about a year, he'll be done with that and want to come back to Texas. This is the dream job by College Station, right? His home church. Yes.
2 years.
All right, we'll give him 2 years. That's right, because we need help with the new sanctuary. Yes, yes. He was here yesterday afternoon, he and Bill, and I'm looking at a camera set up in the back there near the ceiling. He was doing that, had wires hanging from the ceiling. That's what Joseph does. And he's self-motivated. He has uses his own ingenuity and has given us a lot. And I think before he leaves, they're talking about maybe putting a screen somewhere here so we can use that in our services with the sermons and everything, and songs and scripture readings. So he ain't gone yet. But Joseph, we're really proud of you. We're proud for the opportunity that you have. I'm excited for that. I think that's amazing. You bet. I was talking to a pastor just the other day, they were talking about how that New Tabor and Joseph, you know, we lead the unity in innovation and technology, and it's because of what you've done. I think Pee Wee really started that, and then you just took it and jumped on a rocket ship and went crazy with it. And we have been so blessed, and I am so spoiled. But that means somebody needs to step up until Joseph comes back. So, you know, I think he's already working on that. So that's great, Joseph. So we are definitely, I'm going to go ahead and just do this because it's going to be on us before we know it. We're going to have a special Sunday for him, a little party after service. And being that he's going to Hawaii. Yeah. I plan on preaching in LA, Joseph. We're gonna have everybody come. Yeah, I'm gonna do it. Everybody comes in. We're gonna put a lay around your neck, and it's gonna be good. We're gonna have a great time. So we're sort of putting that together as quick as we can. But Joseph, we love you. We appreciate you, man. You know my opinion privately. I've told you 1,000 times, and I've done it publicly too. But I just want you to know how much we appreciate you. Amen. Anyone else? Okay. Good deal. You made a wise decision by coming to worship God openly with us. God's here. The Bible says where two more gathered in his name, God is there in our midst. So he's here today. He's here. So I want you to expect some great things. Expect him to challenge you. Expect him to heal you, touch you, supply your needs. Expect him to do God-level things in your life. If you're not, I just don't know why we bother. If we really believe that God is who he says he is and he's capable of doing what he has promised us, then we should just believe it and just walk in that. Amen. So let's have that attitude today in our service today, and let's expect great things from God. Stand with me, please, across this room. Let's go into this worship asking God to be with us. Father, we love you. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for your power. We thank you for the peace of mind that we have, that even though this world that we live in is such a mess, that you, God, are with us. You, God, are going to make everything turn out right because you do all things well. So, Father, we lean on you. We depend upon you. And most of all, today, we worship you together. We're going to lift up our voices with billions of people across this planet that are worshiping our lovely, wonderful, all-powerful God. So we thank you for being with us and changing our lives. In Jesus' name, all of God's children say with me, amen. Remain standing. Pull out your green hymnals, okay? And let's sing together old style. Page 155. Mike, is it on?
We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love, for Jesus, this rock on above. Thine the glory, hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory, revive us again. We praise thee, O God, for thy Spirit of light, who has shone out our Savior and scattered our night. Verse 4, revive us again, fill each heart with thy love, may each soul be rekindled from fire from above. Hallelujah, thine the glory, hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory, revive us again.
Now for the public reading of the Word of God, page 551, turn in the backs of your hymnals. It's called Fellowship. Yours will be the bold letters and mine with the non-bold. Page 551. Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil and cleave to that which is good. Be kindly affectioned one to another with brotherly love. In honor, preferring one another. Not slothful in business, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. Rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer. Distributing to the necessity of saints, given to hospitality. Bless them which persecute you. Bless and curse not. Rejoice with them that do rejoice, and weep with them that weep. Be of the same mind one to another. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceit. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. Amen. This is the word of God, and it is true and dependable. Amen. Remain standing. Let's continue to sing. And this is a song that I wanted to do. This comes from when I was a child, and I found it in the old books. So let's do our best.
All three verses, 122.
Would you live for Jesus and be always pure and good? Would you walk with him?
I have no voice.
You may be seated. Thank you, sweetie. It's time for us to give to the Lord in our tithes and offerings. By the way, our Bible study on Tuesday nights, we're going to begin Malachi, which speaks of giving, tithes, and offerings. And if you're in a Bible study and you haven't been coming, this is a great time to start because we're beginning a new book. We've been the recipient of so many gifts in the community. People that live outside of town have been helping us. They've been loving us and seeing our plight and saying, we stand with you. And it just warms the heart. I know what it feels like to receive now. This church has given so many times to so many people, and now we are on the other end of that, and it's just beautiful. But we still get to give, amen? So I want to encourage you to give as unto the Lord. Be obedient in your tithes and offerings. Remember, my mom used to tell me, you can never outgive God, and that's a fact. So let's give back to him as he's given us. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this beautiful opportunity that we have to be a part of your kingdom, not only by faith, but in substance, as we give to the work of the kingdom, as we become a part, thank you for allowing us to share with you in that blessing. We love you, Father. We give with a cheerful heart. In Jesus' name, God's children say with me, amen. May be seated. It's time for our ministry moments. If you have seen God do something or God's used you and you've been a part of affecting someone's life or you've been a part of causing someone else to rise up, God's used you. I'd like for you to let me know. Let's go ahead and share our moments that we have had ministry this week. Anyone? Okay. Let's go straight. Rhonda, would you please come at this time? We're going to pray for our needs.
I was thinking of sharing this lesson that I heard this week. Anyway, and then it was in our responsive reading. So I want to share an illustration or a sort of insight into a scripture that I had never heard before. And it's the scripture that we read on heaping coals of fire. And this does go with prayer because this is what we need the most, I feel like, and what I personally experience and what I hear from you guys and other people too. But the concept of heaping coals of fire, I just had totally misunderstood. And I heard someone teach this week how that the communities in the time that this scripture was written, the communities would have a big bonfire in the middle of the community. And so most of the time, most everyone would go out and work in the fields or be working to provide for the whole community and their families. and their personal families. And so this bonfire, someone would always be in charge of keeping the bonfire burning so that at the end of the day, when everyone would come in, they would go and get coals off of the bonfire and take it into their home. And that way they didn't have to start preparing dinner by building a fire. The fire was built. Now they just began to prepare for the evening to keep their home warm, to keep, you know, to make food, and to just do everything that they did in life required fire. And so to heap coals of fire on someone comes into play because many people didn't live in the city, in the tight community. They would live outside of the city. So they would go and gather coals. But as they went further and further away from the fire, of course, their coals would become less effective. And so the people who lived further to the gates, they would, and as these people would go out of the city, they would put their coals in with theirs, with the people's, to help keep them burning so that they could get home and have an easy, build a fire easily. And so to heap coals of fire on someone was to sustain them. It was to warm their home. It was to help them have warm water. It was to help them be able to cook. It was to make life easier for them. And so the word tells us that if anybody has offended us or harmed us in any way, to do good to them. And in doing so, we heat coals of fire on their head. I'm not even going to tell you what I always thought that meant. But it was much more satisfying to my flesh. But spiritually, it's much more satisfying because it is just like the nature of the Lord. We're doing good to those who have harmed us. And so I just want to encourage you this morning that if you have any unforgiveness in your heart against anyone, that's not saying that it isn't just. Sometimes people do things to us, and it's just for us to be really upset. We have every right. As a matter of fact, I can't tell you how many times I've been ministering and saying we need to forgive them. And then the next thing that I hear is why it's hard for them to forgive. And I'm like, yes, that's terrible. That's awful. They shouldn't have done that. That's terrible. You are justified to want to hold unforgiveness in your heart. But we can't do that because the word tells us in many different ways that if we hold aught in our heart, that we won't be forgiven and our prayers won't be heard. So the number one prayer we need to pray today is, I forgive them. I release them. I give them to you. Just as the Lord has forgiven us, we're instructed to forgive those who've done bad things to us. So now let's take our second prayer request. That's number one, is for ourselves and for our own hearts. So does anyone else have any requests that are new this morning or that are more urgent? Anyone? Okay, I believe we prayed for them Tuesday night. Thank you for reminding me. Okay, anyone else? Yes, sir. And Ken Bogey, too. Okay, anyone else? All right, would you stand together and let's go to the Lord and remember those that we've been praying for week after week. There are many, many, many. Everyone in here has a long list if we were really going to share our hearts. But let's go to the Lord and pray. Father, thank you so much for hearing our prayers. Thank you, Lord, for your interest in us, your care for us. Lord, you care about everything that involves us. If we care about it, you care about it too. We aren't better parents than you are. So if we care about the knot in our child's tennis shoe, you care about every detail in our lives too. And so, Father, we just ask for you to just let your love be known today and let everyone here understand in a deeper, more relevant way how much you love them. And, Father, we release those who have done bad things, hurtful things, harmful things, those who have worked against us to harm us. We just forgive them right now, not by our own ability. Some of us, we just can't do it. But Lord, we know that you and the power of your Holy Spirit will come along and help us if we even have a will to try to do it. So, Lord, right now, by the faith that you've given every one of us, we release and forgive people who have harmed us and hurt us and who have done harm to our families and our loved ones. And, Father, we just let them go, and we just ask for you to bless them. We bless those who have hurt us. We bless those, Lord. We ask for you to touch them, and we pray, Lord, for you to help them to prosper. I pray, Lord, that you would help them to understand what they've done and help them to have a repentant heart and help them, Lord, to come to you and to change their lives. And Father, we ask for you to bless them and their children and their grandchildren. We ask for you to minister to them in every way that they need ministry, Lord. Bless them financially. Bless them with good health. Bless them, Father, that they would have joy that's unspeakable and peace that passes all understanding. We just bless those who hurt us. We bless them in Jesus' name. And in so doing, we heap coals of fire on their heads to sustain their lives, to bless them, and to make life easier for them. Lord, we just ask, Father, for you to touch Melvin Skybine. Please minister to that family. We ask for comfort. And we ask, Lord, for your ministry to just touch their hearts and lift them up, Father. We ask for you to touch Ronald Unick and Ken Bogie and so many among us who need a touch from you today. There are people here who need financial help. There are people here who need wisdom for their business and for their home. There are people here today, Lord, who need healing in their bodies. And Father, there are people here who need to be delivered from all types of oppression, footholds, strongholds, and from the cares of this world, Lord, and from their focus being on things that are less than you. Please refine our focus today, Lord, and help us to focus on you and concentrate on you and to hear the word of the Lord today as it goes out. We pray these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, hon. If our children would please come at this time, all the youngsters, come on up here. Here comes the future volleyball team of New Table Brethren. Yeah. All right. I know that was a little higher, isn't it? Yeah, I need to work on that. I'm not very good at candelology. I'm trying. So we want to ask God to bless you, to protect you, to keep you safe. We believe in you. We believe God has a plan for your life. And all we're going to do is agree with him that the best will be done to you, that you'll be secure, confident, well, healthy, and that you will always respect and know that God loves you and he has a plan for your life. So we're going to bless you together. If you would stand, congregation, I'd like you to stretch your right hand of blessing toward these young people. And let's ask God right now to touch and to bless their lives. Sweetie, if you get on that end, I'll start here. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we bless these young people, Lord. We know, God, that you said to forsake not these children to come to you. You want them to come to you and be with you. Father, I pray that you'd be with them, lead them, guide them, guard them, Father. I pray that you be with them in school, wherever they go, Father. I pray that you give them a clear mind to study hard and to do well at every subject they have. I pray that you give them favor with their friends and their teachers and their staff. I pray, God, that your light and salt be on them, Father. I pray, God, that no weapon ever formed against them would prosper. And as they are a heritage from you, God, we treat them as such. We ask that you would be with them, God. We thank you for trusting us with them. And we extend our blessings with yours upon their lives in Jesus' name. God's children said, amen. You guys, hold on 1 second. I got something for you. There ain't nobody too old for stuff like this. I know that because I got adults that try to hit me up afterwards for this. Come on. Here you go. Get you one, okay? You want to help little sis with something? There you go. There you go. You notice they came to me. I didn't have to go to them. All right, everybody got something? Coop, there you go. Good deal. Choose wisely, Padawan. There we go. All right. Am I leaving anything out? I feel like I am. Mid-sermon, I'll think, oh, no. All right. So this is my first opportunity to preach in the new sanctuary. The last couple Sundays, Rhonda and Mike spoke and did an excellent job. We first talked about, in this series, on a new day, I don't want to say prophetically, but boy, it sure was something. But the first message in this New Day series was that God's going to lead us. He's going to guide us. And we're going to know He's leading us because He chose for the children of Israel to create a pillar of fire by night and a pillar of a cloud by day. When I drove around the corner on that fateful Wednesday, I believe it was a Wednesday, and I could see a pillar of fire and a pillar of smoke rising from the distance in this building. But we should follow God. We should follow God. When He leads us, go. Let's pack up and let's move. And we had to in this moment, and we did. The next week, Rhonda talked about God's leading us through hearing His voice and understanding and listening to Him. Listen for Him. When you pray, don't just throw your request out there, but stop. And listen and say, God, what do you want to tell me? What can I do for you for us to listen to God? And then last week, God being the supreme architect of all things, He does do all things well, and nothing goes without His view and without His concern, and that He is guiding us. He is protecting. He is building our future, and we see that in this new day that we're walking into. Today, I want to do something I don't think I've ever done, and we got to go old school because we don't have a screen. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Matthew chapter 1, Matthew 1. We're going to read verses 1 through 18 of Matthew chapter 1. I've never preached on the baguettes. Some people that have started to read their Bible, they get to this place and they're worn out by verse 7. Of all these baguettes, and I think Barney's here. No, Barney, yes, Barney's here, isn't he? Yeah, he's here. So, Barney, if I have a hard time with some of these big names, you're going to help me out? Yes, will do. So, Matthew chapter 1, verses 1 through 18, the book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Here we go. Abraham begat Isaac, and Isaac begat Jacob, and Jacob begat Judas and his brethren. And Judas begat Phares and Zerah of Thamar, and Phares begat Esrom, and Esrom begat Aram. Aram begat Amminadab, and Amminadab begat Naasson, and Naasson begat Salmon. Salmon begat Boaz or Booz of Rahab, and Rahab is actually Rahab. And Booz begat Obed of Ruth, and Obed begat Jesse. And Jesse begat David the king, and David the king begat Solomon of her that had been the wife of Urias. Solomon begat Roboam. Roboam begat Abiah, and Abiah begat Asa. Asa begat Jehoshaphat begat Joram, and Joram begat Ozias. Ozias begat Jotham, and Jotham begat Achaz, and Achaz begat Ezekias. Ezekias begat Manasseh, and Manasseh begat Ammon, and Ammon begat Josias. Is everyone still with me? Yes? Josias begat Jeconias and his brethren about the time they were carried away to Babylon. And after they were brought to Babylon, Jeconias begat Salathiel, and Salathiel begat Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel begat Abiud, and Abiud begat Eliakim, and Eliakim begat Azor. Azor begat Sadok, Sadok begat Akim, and Akim begat Eliud. And Eliud begat Eleazar, Eleazar begat Mathan, and Mathan begat Jacob. Jacob begat Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. So all the generations from Abraham to David are 14 generations, and from David until the carrying away into Babylon are 14 generations. And from the carrying away into Babylon unto Christ are 14 generations. What a coincidence, right? Now, the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise when, as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Physical conditions can prevent you from having natural children. It happens. But nothing can stop you from giving rise to spiritual offspring. In this new day, I want you to be someone who begets. The word beget means to give rise to. This is one of the purposes of our life, is to give rise to other people, to touch and affect their lives. As ministry moments, we've been doing this for some time now, where this is one of the few Sundays where someone hasn't come up. But in these ministry moments, we demonstrate how God gave rise to someone else by allowing us to be used by him. So even though you may not have ever been able to have children in a natural way or form, you can absolutely beget many, many children in the faith. One of the signs of living in the new day is to give rise to. If only thing you're giving rise to is taxes and working your job or making that truck payment or doing whatever you're doing besides giving rise to the kingdom, it's not our purpose. It's one of the things that we do in this life, but it's not why we're born. This is why a lot of people, when they live their lives out and they're doing all these things that we do as Americans, and they don't really have a spiritual place or a spiritual life, the time comes in their life, they'll say, what does this all mean? What is the purpose in life? What am I here for? Well, it's very clear what we're here for if we'll understand we are here to give rise to people of God. We're here to share the smile of Christ, to share the generosity of Christ, to share the salvation of Christ with other people. That's why we're alive. To do that, you got to get over yourself. To do that, you have to sacrifice your emotions, your ego, your shyness. And that's really what one of the things that Paul is talking about. He said, when I was a child, I did things like a child. I spoke as a child. You know, I was shy like a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. Becoming a man, becoming a woman in Christ, is learning what your purpose is and then practicing and walking in that purpose, making a difference in this community. It is obvious that this congregation has made a difference in this community because of the crisis and trial that we went through. There was tons of affection and prayers and what can we do and concern that continues to be poured out upon us. One of our good friends, Steve Holder, who is the president of the Fellowship Network that Ron and I are credentialed through, a very large independent organization. And he found out, I guess through Facebook, because I haven't called Steve, and you know, I haven't been calling people saying, oh, our church burned down, help me. I haven't been doing that, you know. I mean, people find out because of social media. And he said, I know David and Rhonda, they're good friends of mine, and this church is a good church, and whatever you can do, help them in any way you can. We've experienced other people loving us and holding us and being with us through this crisis. We have an opportunity to do that every single day. Every time you come across a stranger, you have an opportunity to bring light and salt into that person's life, to beget something new and fresh in them. Because what they're going to see with you, they're going to say, you know what, if that's that important to him, if that means so much to her that they're willing to just talk to a perfect stranger, that must be real, what they have. I'm going to tell you something. If I had something like millions of dollars and I didn't know how to spend it or what to do with it, I'd probably try to find people to give it away to. And I would say, well, I wouldn't give you $1 million, but you know, just a little shy. I'm not going to talk to you on the cereal aisle. If I had that type of resources where I could give as much as I wanted away and still have more than I could ever deal with, I'd give it. How about you? Are you with me? You have something much more valuable than that. You have Jesus Christ in your heart and in your life. He has changed you. He has sealed you for eternity. And we should share that by giving rise to other people in their lives. Everybody goes through crisis. One of the things that I've heard from one of my mentors, and I've adopted this, and some of you have heard this from me, and you have adopted it too. But crisis. Here are the three facts in this life that you're going to deal with as far as crisis is concerned. You are either coming out of crisis, you are either in crisis, or you're about to go into crisis. That's a fact of life. You're going to be in one of the three stages of crisis, because crisis is normal to life. A lot of people don't understand that. They don't realize that. When a crisis happens to them, they act like something has invaded, and, oh, I don't deserve this. We don't deserve anything. God doesn't owe us anything. And we're going to go through crisis. But what he said was, I'm going to be with you. I'm never going to leave you or forsake you. Even when you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will be with you. My rod and staff, they're going to comfort you. So God has promised these things to us. But it's not common knowledge to everybody. We need to share that. We need to share the love and the life and the light of God with other people. Get over our shyness. Every single time I witness to a complete stranger, it's tough for me to do. But I've noticed the more I do it, the easier it becomes. For those of you that do the restaurant ministry, okay, that means when you're sitting at the table and a wait staff comes to you, and right before you eat or before you get your food, you say, oh, what was your name? Holly? Holly, I'm David. And everybody at this table, we're Christians. We love God. And we pray for our food. Now, before we do that, we want to pray for you. Is there anything specific that you have for us that you want us to pray for? Every time they give us a need or something to be thankful for, and then we pray for them. But you have to get over that moment to do that. I'm not going to ask how many salesmen out here there are, but I bet you that many of you are. You're in the public realm. You do business. We don't get shy about that, do we? You want to make money, don't you? You go and you sell yourself to a new employer. You tell them what you have. You give them a resume. You present yourself. We get over that because it brings us something tangible. Why in the world shouldn't we beget in other people's lives life, salvation, eternity? Amen? We should be willing to do that, but we got to get over that. And every single time I do it, I have to sacrifice myself. I'd rather just sit there and enjoy my salad. I'd rather just sit there and just look into the big, beautiful eyes of my wife, the hazel eyes of my, and just sit and talk with her. I'd rather just do that. But I have disciplined myself to do my best every chance I get to share Jesus with other people, to beget, to give rise to in other people's life what I have, to share with them the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is the way we should approach this new day, to learn to beget, to learn to give rise to. As we just read, one of the ladies in the genealogy of Jesus Christ was a harlot. Rahab, the harlot in Jericho. This lady, she gave protection to the spies that spied out the land. And they said, take this cord, hang it on your house. Everyone's in your house. We won't touch. Everyone in the city was destroyed but her household. And here she goes into Israel as a foreigner. And here her name shows up in the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the ultimate Jew, the ultimate Israeli, the one that would save their people from their sins. So it doesn't matter who you've been, where you've been, what you've done. You have the opportunity, you have the power, and you have the privilege of giving rise in someone else's life. If Rahab the harlot is part of giving rise to Jesus Christ the Savior, so you have that same opportunity to give rise in other people's lives. Say, amen, are you with me? Yes. Now, this is why we give rise to other people, because living in Christ is like a fountain of sweet water. Everywhere you go, you have water with you. You have living water that is flowing inside you. Whether you realize it or not, people are drinking of that water. They see, they sense. I've had people ask me questions in the store. Why do you whistle? What are you happy about? That's another opportunity to say, well, my soul is saved. Jesus, forgive me my sins. What are you happy about? It's a way, because this is something that is inside of us, that is something that we get to share with other people. I had, during the fire, the reporters come at me and they wanted to ask me the questions. I was in crisis during the fire. I was experiencing trauma during the fire. No, I haven't been here for 73 years. I'm only 65. I've been here for 19 years. My sons were raised in this church. We went to high school. All three of my boys are Hornets. Okay? They graduated here. We've invested ourselves in this community. My son, my oldest son, was married in that building. All three of my sons were confirmed in that building. A lot of other great victories that we experienced in that building over there. And now it's burning down. I've got property there that I have shared with the church. Gone. Gone forever. And I was experiencing the loss in the sense that, like everybody else was, and then somebody puts a microphone in my face. And they asked me some questions, and what came out of me was that part of that living fountain, that water that bubbles up inside of every Christian. You see, this is the opportunity we have to bring light, to beget hope in other people's hearts and lives. I wanted to just sit there and mourn. I just want to sit there and just feel bad. But I had an opportunity during the crisis to say something about God. Your life in Christ will give rise to other people. In Christ, you are His fertile offspring. You have the power, you have the ability to give rise to other people's lives. Let's go to Romans chapter 9. Romans chapter 9, verses 6 through 8. Word says here, it says, "It is not as though God's word had failed, for not all who are descended from Israel are Israel. Not all people who claim to be Christians are. Not all people who go to church are godly. Nor because they are His descendants are they all Abraham's children. On the contrary, it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned." In other words, it is not the children by physical descent who are God's children, but it is the children of the promise who regarded as Abraham's offspring. You see, we are children of the promise, not only through Isaac, but through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. So we have the ability to give rise to more offspring by just sharing your life, sharing what Jesus has done for you. One of the blessings that we give the children as we bless them, God, I pray that God will reveal His purpose in their life. That never one time in their life will they ever stop and say, "What's the meaning of life?" It frustrates me to no end when I meet fellow clergy who ponder that question. What is this really all about? What is the meaning of life? What a deep question. It's not a deep question if you're in Christ Jesus. Because you've met the meaning of life. You've experienced your purpose. You get it. You understand that it doesn't end at salvation. Now you are to be a begetter. You're being a person that gives rise to other people's lives, to overcome whatever physical limitations the enemy puts in front of you, and to be who God has called you to be, His servant, His messenger. See, this is why it's so important that we understand that we are children of the promise, and we don't keep the promise. We share the promise. Amen? We share that promise with other people. It's not a secret. It's a promise. So many Christians treat the promise like a secret. Are you a Christian? Well, it's very personal. I don't really want to say much about it. Well, the fact is we're scared. The fact is we're too shy. The fact is we haven't gotten over that yet. The fact is we haven't understood that the promise is more important than our personalities and our inhibitions. We need to be willing and ready to give rise to. You may say, "Well, preacher, pastor, I'm not there yet." Well, you can get there. You can get there. Amen? You'll do what you should do. In this current situation that we're in, what are we going to do? We're going to do what we have to do. We're going to do it because we don't have a choice. And that's exactly what we're doing. We're going to continue to do what we do. Who was it? Larry Kozlowski, the president of the Unity of the Brethren. He called, he's so sweet, this guy, pastor's out of Crosby, you know, Brother Larry. He called me the other day, said, "Hi, Dave." Pretty good, isn't it? "Hi, Dave, how are things going?" I said, "Well, you know." I said, "It's going great." I said, "I pastor Brethren people." I said, "They are a well-oiled machine." I said, we got a job to do, we're going to do it, we're doing it, and it's going to be okay. Because we don't have a choice. And as a child of God, as a person who's been redeemed by the blood of Jesus, you don't have a choice. The Bible says, "Let your light shine. Be a beacon on a hill." Don't run around with a secret. "Well, I'm not going to, you know, I don't want to be controversial. I live to talk about politics and religion." Amen? Amen. You hear my wife laughing? New members of the family, Casey and Cassie, sit at our dinner table. And we get into a big discussion, which is code for debate. We get a big discussion about religion and politics, and here we go. And they just marvel, thinking, what? Is that what y'all do when you sit around the table? Yes, it's what we do. We engage in life. We engage with who we are. And we do our best because we don't have a choice. We have a call on our lives to live for Christ and do our best to share the gospel. We give rise to everything around us. Your life in Christ gives rise to others for a new day. You give rise to hope. You beget hope in other people's lives. Encouragement you give. Light you give. Salt. You're the flavor of this world. And this world has one flavor. Go work. Make your truck payments. Your house payments. Pay taxes. That's coming up. All these things that we got to do. All these things. Obey the traffic laws. Everything that you do. These are things we have to do. And if that's all your life is about, I pity you. If you don't have any other excitement, and you know what? If you're depending on your football team bringing you joy, I pity you. You can pity me too. On the same day that we had the fire, Nick Saban resigned. I thought, oh my goodness, what am I going to do? If that's all I had, I would be miserable. Because everything you hold and cleave to and pull for is going to lose sooner or later. But God, never lose. He'll never let you down. He'll always love you. He'll always pull for you. He'll always be on your side. Wow. What can man do to me? What should I fear in this world when God is for me? Who can be against me? See, that's life. That's hope. That's why we keep going. That's why we don't stumble and sit down and mope around in a puddle of tears, because there's more to life than that. And those that have ears to hear and eyes to see, those that understand there's an architect in control of all things. Listen, we have hope and we can walk in this new day that God has destined. Yeah, destined for you. That's your purpose in life. That's what you're supposed to be doing. That's what you can do, and that's what you must do. John chapter 7 and verse 38. Scripture says, whoever believes in me, as Scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them. Wow. These invisible waters will flow within you, and the people you come in contact with, especially when you decide to share your life in Christ with them. And you can do it without being a bore. You can do it without being overbearing. You need to master that craft. I'm not asking anybody in here to be a vacuum cleaner salesman. If you are, I don't want to, you know, besmirch that. But I want to encourage you to share your testimony. These rivers of living water. There's been some new study, some new research in archaeology that's taken place that they have zeroed down that Mount Sinai is not in the Sinai Peninsula. Look it up. Go Google that. It's fascinating. But they found Mount Sinai on the other side of the Red Sea, where it's really supposed to be. Wouldn't make sense, would it, for them to cross the Red Sea? Now let's go back to Mount Sinai. No, it was on the other side. It's actually in Saudi Arabia. It's out in the desert. This mountain of God that the Saudis have been holding for a secret, you know, for a long time. This mountain, it has a black top where it's been scorched. Duh. Makes sense, doesn't it? And all the other things that are there, they have found a rock that's about 5 stories high, a big, massive boulder. And this massive boulder has a split in it that goes down. And all around this big, huge boulder, they've found evidence where hydraulics have taken place, where water has flowed so much that it has smoothed the rock all around it. They have found erosion where massive amounts of water. And the Bible tells us that Moses spoke to the rock and the rock produced water. And that water provided water for all the flocks and the million plus of the Israelites. Now, everything I've ever seen on my flannel graphs in Sunday school when I was a child, the little coloring books, was Moses standing in front of a rock, right? And this little trickle coming down. It wasn't a trickle, guys. It had to feed millions of people and or cause, you know, relieve the thirst of millions, plus livestock. And here's the evidence in the middle of the desert of this place where the water has actually carved the stone down and eroded it. And they said it has to be massive. And I looked at some pictures of what that would have looked like. It was just unbelievable. I'm just massive, huge. And I'm thinking, that's what's in us. We have that same thing inside of us, except these are rivers of living water, and it does satisfy the thirst of the people we come in contact with. Not a trickle, friend. It says living water that will flow from within them, rivers of living water. And that living water in you will give rise to life around you. That water of Moses, that water of the wilderness after the Red Sea on the Mount of God, that water gave rise to, caused the desert around them to come alive. That water that is in you now, it begets a new day. The only question that you're going to have to answer is, what am I going to do with it? Am I going to cap it, save it for a rainy day or a dry day, or am I going to go ahead and walk in my destiny and my purpose? It's why you're alive. It's why you're living. It's why you're breathing. It's why you're exhaling. It's to be a catalyst for God, to stand in His place, be His representative, His ambassador, Scripture says, and to give rise to other people. You may say, well, Pastor, I don't have that type of influence and people won't listen to me. I'm going to pray. That's our alarm to thank God. We're going to do that in just a second. You say, well, I don't have that charisma. You know, it doesn't go that quickly for me. It's not that easy. But you got the water. God's not going to touch other people's lives through charisma. You know what I've seen people with charisma do in the kingdom? I've seen them damage it. I've seen them just walk in their own charisma and make a wreck and a mess of everything. God never wants you to change people with charisma. He wants you to change people with water. And He'll provide it. All you got to do is let it go. Let it flow. And trust God. Overcome your own limitations. Some of you guys probably going to believe this, but man, when I was in school, I was a shy guy. I was very shy, very timid, worried about what people thought about me, blah, 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 until I got a hold of baptism of the Holy Spirit. And I became a firebrand after that. But that was just the water of God flowing through me, and I let it go. I just let it go. You can change lives. You can give rise to lives by allowing that water flow from you into other people's lives. I dare you to do that. I dare you to overcome your shyness and be a testimony to someone. Tell them what God means to you. And if you say, well, I don't really know what He means to me, then find out. Find out. I've told you for years and years and years that you don't live on that salvation moment or that confirmation moment. It's a daily walk. God will do something new in you now, tomorrow, next week. The Bible says His mercies are new every morning. So you can have a fresh encounter with God. When I was saved, I had a dynamic encounter. God did some great things. But if I look back and said, yeah, 8 years old, that's all I got. No, I've lived for more moments in Him. And I've experienced more moments as I've just opened myself up to Him and said, God, do what You will. Get a life. Get a life in Christ. And then share that. Let the water flow. And watch what God will do. I promise you, you won't be disappointed. And your environment will be a lot better off than it is right now. Bow your heads with me, please. Let's pray. Father, I love You and I thank You that You have given all of us the ability to beget. The ability to give rise to. And Father, the people that we touch, the people that we affect, and we may not even know this. We will in heaven. But right now, we may live our life and die and never know what You did because we were willing to give ourselves. I pray, Father, that You challenge every man, woman, and child in this room to rise up and to give rise to as we walk in this new day of promise, a new day of power, a new day of possibilities. Thank you, Father, that with you there's always a new day. You are the God of new beginnings and new life. Thank you for being who you are. Now, Father, with this congregation, I want to give you thanks. I want to thank you for loving me. I want to thank you for giving your life for me on a cross, even though I didn't deserve it. You did it because you loved me, not because of anything I earned, but you did it because you loved me. And I thank you for that. I thank you for life. I thank you for hope. I thank you for happiness and joy that you put in my life. Father, I just thank you for being you. You mean so much to me, and I love you very much. Receive me, Father, as I love you back. I know that you first loved me. I don't know why, but you did. And I love you back today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Rhonda? Thank you, brother.
Sing Blessed Assurance, number 120. And let's sing all three verses.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above. Echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Hands with me, please. I want to bless you today. I bless you with living waters that will flow out of you. And as a child of the promise, give rise to the environment in which God has placed you. Christ in you brings a new day to others around you. In Jesus' name, I bless you. Amen and amen. We now have a meeting. I tell you what, let's give a 5-minute recess.
Hold on to me as we go, as we roll down this unfamiliar road.